so many open doors. A brand new mercy on all within new day. That's why
That's it. Worship the Lord. I worship him. Come on. He's brought you over some mountains. Come on. Tell him thank you. Come on. Tell him thank you. That's it. Let's worship the Lord. He desires our praise tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless you.
To the master.
Give yourself to the master.
Oh, he can make your life.
You make your life so blind.
Oh, so blind.
Give yourself to Jesus.
For you.
Condolences to the family of Mother Paralee. She's a beautiful lady. The time I got a chance to just speak to her, she used to encourage my heart after worship and just tell me how good I was doing. She was just an encourager to my heart. So let us pray, okay? Lord, I just thank you so much, Father. First of all, Lord, bring comfort right now to the family of Paralee, Lord, and just let them know, Lord, that there's joy in the morning, and God, Lord, that Paralee is with you. She is with you, Father. And one day we'll see her again, Lord. For those who are in Christ, we will see her again, God. So, God, Lord, we just thank you for all that you've done, Lord, for this family, God, and continue to build them up, bring them peace and joy, God, and, again, comfort, Lord. And Lord, we just thank you, God, for the life of Paralee. This is a home-going celebration, God, and we just thank you for all that she has done over 97 years, Lord. That is a blessing, 97 years, God. And Father, we just say thank you. Everyone say thank you, Lord. We just say thank you, Lord. Say thank you, Lord, for just letting us have her for 97 years, Lord, and blessing our lives, Lord. So she touched so many lives, God. So God, we give you all the glory, and we thank you, Lord, for the name that is above all names, for you are Christ Jesus. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And amen.
I greet you all in the name of Jesus. My name is Pastor Boniface Gitao. I'm one of the ministers here at Abundant Life Faith Fellowship. My condolences to you, family and friends. I pray that the Lord will console your hearts. I will read 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Verse 13 through 18, the word of the Lord gives us consolation. And this is what the Lord says. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. So we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left to be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. May the Lord bless you.
I say, praise the Lord to everyone. We're here for the homegoing of Aunt Paralee. At this time, we're going to have a musical or instrumental selection, His Eye is on the Sparrow by Reggie Jones. Thank you. She's going to share acknowledgments.
Praise the Lord. Whereas Paralee Wilmer has been a faithful member of Carmel Presbyterian Church since 1948, serving as a deaconess on the usher board and being recognized as one of the shining stars of Carmel. Whereas Paralee has shown the world that she is a child of God, and this is a homegoing celebration for her to be with our Lord and Savior. Our hearts are with you as we gather to bid a Christian farewell to our beloved friend and sister in Christ. Whereas Paralee was an outstanding steward who personally gave of her gifts as a seamstress to make sure that everyone looked their Sunday best. And she was known as an excellent baker, winning souls over with her pound cakes, banana bread, and her rolls. Whereas Paralee faithfully attended Sunday services well into her 90s, often driving herself and her faithful friends back and forth to the church. Whereas we believe that the passing of our beloved is heaven's gain, although we are saddened by the love of our the loss of our beloved members, we rejoice that now Paralee Wilmer has transitioned from earthly labor to heavenly reward. And we celebrate that she now joins all of her loved ones that she had to say goodbye to. Therefore, be it resolved that we bow in humble submission to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who knows best. We, the members of Carmel Presbyterian Church, would like to thank the Wilmer family for sharing the gift of this precious life with us. We are eternally grateful for her love, her ministry, and her service as a member of the Carmel Presbyterian Church. Paralee Palmer has been a blessing to us all. We will continue to pray for each of the family members, and we would like to share these words of encouragement as we look forward to the promises of our God through Jesus Christ as declared in Revelations. Please be encouraged by this passage. Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and God shall dwell with them. They will be God's people, and God will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. That's Revelations 2:21-3-4. So be it proclaimed that Paralee Palmer will forever remain in our hearts and in our memories. A copy of this proclamation will be presented to the family, and these proceedings will be recorded in the official records of Carmel Presbyterian Church and the Presbyterian Church USA. To the family, though your loss is deep and your sorrow great, remember that weeping endures for a little while, but with God and through God, joy shall break through as the sun rises in the morning. Humbly submitted on this day, Saturday, April 17th, 2021, the officers and members of Carmel Presbyterian Church, Cincinnati, Ohio, the Reverend Garth E. Adams, pastor. An expression of sympathy. There is a time for gathering all the best of good life and holding it in our hearts forever. To Mary and family, with deepest sympathy, to you and your family in this time of sorrow, love always, Laura and Renee. May warmest thoughts of sympathy help you in some small way to ease your loss and sadness as you face each coming day. Our condolences, but we know that God has your aunt and she is in resting in peace in Christ. May God bless you and your family during these times of grief. Gwen and Jerry McIntosh. Keeping you close and caring thoughts and prayers, though your heart must hold deep sadness at the loss of the one you love, may it also hold the blessings of the life you share and the love that will always be part of you. Praying that God will comfort your heart, uplift your spirit, and carry you through the times of sadness to a place of peace. With deepest sympathy, Jean and Carl Gibson. Because we care, a message of comfort for you. Because we care, our heartfelt thoughts go out to you today with more concern and sympathy than we could ever say. We hope the special love that brings will help you to see you through, and that time will bring you brighter days because we care for you. Abundant Life Faith Family. Beyond life's getaway, there's an open gate at the end of the road through which each must go alone. And there in a light we cannot see, our Father claims his own. Beyond the gate, your loved one finds happiness and rest, and there's comfort in the thought that a loving God knows best. May the same God who has welcomed your loved one home keep you in his care throughout this difficult time. We are praying for you and your family as you grieve the loss of your loved one, Pastor Dale and Carla Tolbert. An acknowledgement for all the kindness you have shown, we thank you very much for sympathy in sorrowing days, for friendship's healing touch. With gratitudes, our hearts are full, though words cannot convey the tender thoughts and thankfulness we hold for you today. The family of Paralee Wilmer, and a formal acknowledgement will take place later. Thank you.
Amen. So you're gonna have to help me out with my memory on this one a little bit. Who is that make the real good rose? Mother Shula? What's the name? Sister who? Schubert. Shortly before Paralee passed, Tammy was over there, and she said, Paralee said, I make rose better than Sister Schubert. And that's probably true. Amen. So she didn't have anything on her. At this time, we're going to have some remarks from a few family members and someone that may just have a very fond memory on your heart. We ask each person to keep your comments to 2-3 minutes, if you will. I'm going to ask Lincoln if he would come first. Amen. We kind of talked already.
My name is Lincoln Petaway, and I've never done this before, but I've been to many funerals and seen this done before. My earliest memories of Aunt Paralee are at 5 or 6 years of age. My father brought me down to see my grandmother, and he said, "You need to see your Aunt Paralee." And I remember, even to this day, when I met her, her receiving me with enthusiasm and excitement and being abundantly available. We've been traveling for a while, and I've lived quite far away. But when I came back into town in 2016, I got in touch with her, and she insisted on making us Thanksgiving dinner. She cooked a turkey at 94. She made string beans, mashed potatoes, cranberry, and she asked us what we wanted for dessert. My father loved my grandmother's sweet potato pie, and I told her sweet potato pie. And she made us a sweet potato pie and packed everything up for us to take home with us. Within a year or two, I came back into town with my father extremely sick. Although I don't know this side of the family very well, the side that I do told me to take my father to his family. And I'm happy to say that my family received us very well. And for the few weeks that we needed to get back on our feet, Paralee opened her doors and said, "Come stay with me." She didn't have much. I went and found some work until I could get back on my feet, and every day she tried to make sure I had breakfast, grits, coffee, toast, eggs, even if I was in a rush and even if I didn't need it, and I appreciate that. And so I just want to acknowledge the wonderful person she was, as much as I possibly can with these stories. Thank you.
Amen. Does someone else have a memory, of an expression of memory you'd like to share?
Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord. Aunt Paralee was my mother's sister. There were 12 of them. And she was number 10 out of the 12. And it was 4 girls and 8 boys. So I met her at birth. Believe it or not, we lived in the same apartment building on Poplar Street. Still remember the address, 822 Poplar Street. She was on the first floor, and we were on the second. Now, those who know me know I'm a storyteller. Don't worry, I'm not going to take up too much time, okay? And I would go down and visit her sometimes, but I know she was really into grooming. So I was no more than 5. But before I knocked on her door, I would pat my hair down and make sure my clothes were okay. And walked into her house. They said, she was an excellent cook, and so was my mother. and had a lot of hospitality. I feel so grateful to have had her in my life. Later, I started going to the same church that she went to. My parents were Baptists, and she was Presbyterian. And so she had me going to church with her. And then when I got a little bit older, I thought, you know, they thought I should make a decision. So I said, I want to go to Auntie Lee's church. I didn't tell them because they had movies and donuts, but that was my choice. But my aunt was always good to me. She was one of the best seamstresses that walked this earth. I'm not just saying the city of Cincinnati. She was one of the best seamstresses that walked this earth. Every prom day, every prom I went to, she had me laid out. And then when Steve and I got married, she made my wedding dress. And before you leave, look in the hall. It's a picture of us, our marriage picture in the hall. You'll see that dress she made. She was always there for my brother and I to do what she could to help us be what we could be. And I feel so blessed and I feel so honored that she was a part of my life. She taught me a lot. Thank you.
Amen. Do we have anyone else that would like to share a thought or a memory of Aunt Paralee? Amen. At this time, we're going to silently read the obituary. And I would like to say this. My daughter, Tammy, was scheduled to be out of town, and so she's not able to be here. But Tammy is kind of like the family historian, and she would talk to some of our seniors and get information of what has happened along the way, and so she would record it. And in fact, when we get to the eulogy today, after reading through what Tammy had written in the obituary and talking to her, if she had have been here, she would have been the one sharing the eulogy. And so we're going to see it via video a little later. But and so as we silently read through the obituary, it will take you with a walk through history. You have to remember, someone that was 97 years old, seen a lot, lived through a lot. She talks about the first vote that she cast when blacks were allowed to begin to vote. Amen. So let's read the obituary. Yes. In the program, I believe it's the first three paragraphs of the obituary, there's a special insert that has the full wording of the obituary, so you can later read through it and have a more detailed historical look at her life. At this time, we're going to have a selection by James Smith.
Can we agree this is a day of rejoice? To be with my Lord.
could feel that sound. Amen. Praise his name. Just before James began to sing, one of our former praise dancers came up and said that Paralee made our first praise dancer outfits. Amen. Amen. At this time, we have a poem by Minister Darrell Pearson.
I say praise the Lord. As stated, my name is Pastor Durr. I'm one of the ministers here at the church, and I count it a double honor to be here to celebrate this great woman of God. Amen. Seamstress, baker, deaconess, auntie. Amen. So in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, it says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. So this piece is entitled, I have fought the good fight. I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have chosen the way of light, although the road may have seemed loaded with obstacles. I know that the Lord was with me even when my eyes could not see him. I know that the Lord was with me even when I could not feel him. I knew he was present. I have fought the good fight. I have stayed in the ring when others were falling away. I would not allow myself to be swayed by the tactics of the enemy. I've had to duck when the enemy was swinging high. I came back up with an uppercut to the chin. I know God was before me. I knew I was going to win. I have fought the good fight. I have maximize the things that God has put in my hands. I have sold garments of faith and steadfastness and helped dress others in the same. I have begged wisdom and understanding and shared with others this life-giving bread. I have shared the goodness of Christ as I have walked in his light. I have fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have, as I come nigh my reward to partake in the treasures I have stored up, as I come to a place where I can worship God and his son Jesus Christ nonstop, I want to encourage you to fight the good fight. Finish your course that the Lord has placed before you. Plant your feet firmly in Christ and be unmoved. Maximize all that God has put in your hands. Be sure to take a stand for what is right. I have fought the good fight of faith. I see you when you get here.
Amen. I fought the good fight of faith. One thing Darrell shared, he probably didn't realize it. He said something about she'll shoot you a uppercut. She will lay hands on you, get out of line. I want you to know that. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to hear from my daughter, Tammy. She's going to share the main part of the eulogy, and I'll just have some final remarks. So at this time, if we could play the video there, she sent it from New Orleans.
You know Hello, everyone. My name is Tammy Brown. I am the great niece of Paralee Wilmer, and it is my honor and privilege to eulogize her. Paralee Wilmer, and she was born Paralee Williams. She was born April 1st, 1924, to Frank and Sadie Williams in Millers Ferry, Alabama. She was the youngest daughter of 12 children. Her siblings, who all preceded her in transition to the next life, included Johnny, Elmo, Posey, Nell, Pat, Clara, Frank Jr., Ida Mae, Paul, Lincoln, and Samuel. She was affectionately called Auntie Lee by her numerous nieces and nephews, that's what I called her, and was known for her outstanding culinary skills and keen ability to sew from scratch or tailor any outfit. Matter of fact, she made my mom's wedding dress, which was quite classy and classic. She made all of my sister's prom dresses, which were quite bodacious, actually. She made several dresses for me, and that was her gift to all of us. That was her skill. So she could sew and tailor any outfit. She possessed a wry sense of humor and quick wit that were no match for the faint of heart, but was mutually appreciated by family and friends who could keep up with her repartee. Now, that's my politically correct way of saying she was a trip. And she would clown you in your face and blast on you. And if you were sensitive, you know, too bad for you. But I personally think she liked me because I could go tit for tat with her, and she would always laugh. During her last days on this earth, she truly enjoyed visits from family and friends in celebration of her 97th birthday. So she passed away just 10 days after her 97th birthday. She passed away peacefully on Sunday, April 11th, 2021. My aunt, Paralee, she was raised on her family's farm in Millers Ferry, and she helped her parents grow cotton, peanuts, green beans, black-eyed peas, corn, collard, mustard, and turnip greens. They were sharecroppers. And so I teach African American history. I actually have a PhD in history. And I tell my students, sharecropping was really just one step above slavery. So the way it worked was there was a white landowner who would parcel out pieces of land to African Americans who were former slaves. And these black farmers would farm that land, and they were required to share a portion of their crops with the white landowner. But it was a vicious system of debt, because usually the black farmers had to buy the seed from the white landowner, the agricultural equipment, and it was intended to further oppress black people and keep them down and not give them their fair shake, their fair share, their due for the work, their own labor. So my aunt was part of a family that was sharecropping this land. And they would sell their hard-earned produce to make money. They also would make homemade cakes and ice cream and sell it to make money. Once, and this is, I think, the perfect example of African-American courage, resilience, faith, the white landowner tried to force my aunt's parents, Frank and Sadie, to keep all of their kids at home. So remember, my aunt had 11 siblings. So the white landowner tried to force them to stay at home in order to produce more on the farm. My aunt's parents refused. So in that refusal, they demonstrated their intelligence, their pride, their resourcefulness, and more than anything, the family had each other to rely on as a source of strength. My aunt, Paralee, met and married the love of her life, Richard Wilmer, in Alabama. Richard was a soldier in the United States Army, and traveled with the military shortly after they married. To hear my aunt talk about her husband is just fills your heart. She talked about how he loved her so much. They met as young kids because he was a friend of one of her brothers, and he liked her. And keep in mind, my Auntie Lee was the youngest girl, and she had two younger brothers. And so the way that she would help the family was she often took care of her younger brothers. And one of her brothers, the baby, was with her so much that Richard, her husband-to-be, actually thought that it was her child, her baby. And it was a while before he actually learned, oh, it's her brother, right? But Richard was just so loving, so gentle, so generous. And shortly after they married, he had to travel with the military. Yeah. While Richard was traveling with the military, my aunt moved to Mobile, Alabama with her older sister, Ida May, then to Selma, Alabama, and then eventually she joined her sisters, Nell and Clara, in Cincinnati, Ohio, and the whole pursuit was for a better life, for better job opportunities. So in the South at the time, the only options were really sharecropping or domestic labor, working in white people's homes, cooking and cleaning. So I even use the example of Auntie Lee's life in my classroom. I've used her life in the classroom for the past 15 years to talk about the great migration of Black people who moved from the countryside to cities in the South, and then from the South to the North, and even from the South to the West, in pursuit of true life, liberty, and happiness, and dare I say, even joy. The fact that Jim Crow racism in America limited Black folks' opportunities and possibilities meant they had to create a way out of no way. They had to rely on the resources of faith and of family, and especially call on a higher power. So now let's dig a little bit deeper with this historical phenomenon of the Great Migration. So the Great Migration that happened, this would be, we're talking about 30, 40 years after the end of slavery. This was the story of Black people taking inspiration from the Bible, the biblical narrative in the Bible in which God told Moses to take the enslaved children of Israel, out of Pharaoh's control, and into Canaan land. Black ministers from slavery times through Jim Crow used that story to uplift themselves and to say, just as God made a way for the children of Israel to have a freedom and a better life, God would make a way for them. And so my aunt and her family were just one among many, really over 500,000 people, African Americans, who called on their strength within and their higher power to move, have the courage to move and get a better life. I just learned this from one of my cousins. It turns out that when my aunt Paralee decided to move, she told her parents that she was just going to visit her sisters in Cincinnati because she was young. She would have been, we're still working on the chronology, but she would have been between age 17 and 19, and her parents didn't want her to move just yet. But she said, I'm just going to visit my sisters. But she went and never came back. And so after Richard finished his military duties, he joined Paralee in Cincinnati, and he worked for the post office, and my Auntie Lee, Paralee, was a homemaker. She took great pride in being a homemaker. Now, for feminists today, empowered women, they might say, oh, she was a homemaker, interesting. They might not fully give her due respect and admiration for being a homemaker, but when I talk about her in my classroom, I pause and I say, let's think about the significance of a Black woman at that time in the 1930s, in the 1940s, in the 1950s to say, I'm a homemaker. Matter of fact, the last time I saw my aunt, I talked to her about a week ago. She literally said to me, I didn't have to work. And she said it as a point of pride. She said it as a point of pride to say, my husband, Richard, provided for me. So now, Black people coming out of slavery, being not only physically, psychologically oppressed, but also literally, financially, materially oppressed, that meant that most Black families, everybody had to work to make ends meet. But the fact that she could do what she wanted to do, that in and of itself for her was an accomplishment. Paralee was a long-standing and very proud member of Carmel Presbyterian Church in Cincinnati. And Carmel Presbyterian Church is known as a congregation of upwardly mobile African Americans. And I make that point to say, consistent with these other historical themes I've been talking about, my aunt lived her life in a way that was really a demonstration of a historical concept called racial uplift. So racial uplift specifically refers to a time in history from the 1880s through the 1920s in which African-American intellectuals and leaders were creating organizations, so creating fraternities, sororities, mutual aid societies, book clubs, Bible clubs, and banding together to think of ways to improve the social and economic standing of African-Americans. Connected to that was also this sense of respectability politics. So to be respectable, you had to dress in a certain way that was, you know, just well-defined and dignified. If you look at pictures of my aunt, my grandparents from that era, they were sharp, right? They didn't dress like we did today. They had their hats, they had their suits pressed, they had their dresses, and, you know, they looked like every day was an event. So my aunt, she took pride in that. She took pride in her appearance, and she would tell you too, if you were out of order. My mom says to this day she can remember when she lived in the same apartment building with my aunt. As a kid, she was around 5, going to my aunt's door, and right before she rang the doorbell, she would just kind of pat her hair down, you know, press her dress down, just to make sure. About a week ago, when I visited her, a little over a week, I was starting to get a little gray showing here. That's all I have, just around the edges. And so I put a headband on just to cover it. I was talking to my aunt about her birthday, and then out of the blue, she just says, oh Lord, are you starting to get some gray? And I'm just like, oh, you know, you have good eyes still. Your eyes are still that good. But she's gonna tell you if something is out of place. But that's part of the story, right? That's part of the story of rising from sharecropping to the status of owning your own home, which she and my uncle did own their own home. And she took pride in taking care of that home. I see the next piece of this puzzle that I'm gonna talk about as a type of work, although she never fully acknowledged it. And I think she never fully acknowledged it because she was of a different generation. Her cooking and her sewing. Paralee, my aunt, she had exceptional talents and she knew it. In a recent conversation that I had with her, she said to me with a smile, I can sew a dress better than any dress you could find at a department store. And I can cook rolls better than Sister Schubert's. So you know, if you know who Sister Schubert is, you can find her rolls in the frozen food section in almost any grocery store. And she literally said that last line to me about a week ago when I saw her. And I said, I just appreciate the fact that she went out so strong. You know, I take joy in that, in the African-American tradition, and I'm recording this in New Orleans, the New Orleans tradition of just celebrating that person's life. The fact that she survived so much racism, sexism, oppression and still had a sense of humor and still was able to smile and talk trash and brag about her skills. And she was rightfully confident. She wasn't boastful, she was rightfully confident. So, like the good stewards of their gifts in the Bible, the biblical story, the parable of the talents, my Auntie Lee, Paralee, she shared her gifts with her family, friends, and community. She didn't just bury her gifts under the sand. She wasn't self-conscious or so humble to say, no, you know, don't look at me, I can't do that. But she gave back to her community. In a recent conversation with my cousin, Dorothy, her nickname is Kitten, she told me that when she was a kid, she would visit my Auntie Lee in Cincinnati, and Auntie Lee would stay up all night cooking rolls, dozens and dozens and dozens of rolls, to sell at bake sales at her church, Carmel Presbyterian Church. And they would make money, you know, for the church off of her gifts, off of her talents. It was nothing for her to make 12 dozen, and she would be up all night. Also, if you know her, you would know the best thing that we have enjoyed is her famous pound cake recipe. And it's a recipe that she has taught other family and friends. So that's another way of sharing and giving back. It was just so moist and rich with a slightly crunchy top, and I'm getting hungry talking about it right now. Mm-hmm. She also made a peach cobbler with homemade crust, soft tea cakes, and she was known for salmon croquettes. I like to think about this as not only a talent that should be celebrated as giving back to the community, but also a way of sustaining herself, a way of fostering her creativity, as the writer Alice Walker has talked about in her book, In Search of Our Mother's Gardens. We have to pay attention and enjoy and celebrate our maternal ancestors, how they found joy and how they found creativity in everyday things, whether it's gardening or it's sewing. And she also made money from it. I say she took on that entrepreneurial spirit that her parents instilled in her when she was a kid, as they sold their homemade baked goods to make ends meet. And she pursued her talent with pride. Paralee's life epitomized the creativity, courage, and resilience required for African Americans to not only survive the financial and psychological stresses of the Great Depression, Jim Crow racism, and even through the Civil Rights Movement, race riots, to today, think about what's going on right now in Minnesota, in Minneapolis, the trial for the murder of George Floyd by a white police officer. These attacks on Black humanity and the Black spirit, to survive all of that and to survive with your sense of self and your sense of creativity intact, I really am in a sense of awe of my aunt. She showed love through her cooking and her sewing. And also her expressions of pride, of her, the accomplishments of me, the accomplishments of all of her nieces and nephews and her great nieces and nephews. So she epitomized the creativity and also the determination of Black people to thrive. Now she leaves behind to celebrate her life and legacy her nieces, Marion Brown, married to Stephen Brown, pastor of Abundant Life Church, Dorothy Starks, Aletha Williams Boone, her nephew Doraynus Williams, and a host of great nieces, great nephews, cousins, and church members. Thank you for just taking the time to listen, to gather, even if we're gathering virtually, if we're gathering with some folks in the same room. Thank you for just taking the time to listen to the story of my aunt's life. Please share this story with others as a point of inspiration. And I just say, my aunt right now, I think she's in heaven, wearing her crown, probably chatting it up with Nefertiti, Cleopatra. You know, maybe let's add to that Coretta Scott King. The Queen. Thank you.
Historical overview of Auntie Paralee. And the final words I'd like to share, I fought a good fight. As Tammy shared, Paralee became a member of Carmel Presbyterian Church, 1948. That was the same year I was born. That means she was a member of one church for 73 years. Paralee had the longest membership in a single church that I'm aware of, and I've been pastoring Abundant Life for about 40 years. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6 through 8, it says, "My life is being given as an offering to God, and the time has come for me to leave this life. I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now a crown is being held for me." A crown for being right with God. The Lord, the judge who judges rightly, will give the crown to me on that day. Not only me, but to all those who have waited with love for him to come again. The labors and toils of this life have come to an end for Paralee. She has fought a good fight. And I want to talk just for a minute about fighting a good fight. She fought a good fight spiritually and naturally. She let you know, Steve, you get him, I'm going to lay hands on him. Get him, I'm going to get my gun out. And spiritually, she stayed the course 73 years in one church. Fighting for her life when she was in the hospital, I remember Marion and I went to see her, and near the end of her life, she was having trouble, hard time getting her breath and breathing. And as she was laying on the bed and she was laboring and breathing, what went through my mind, she was saying to death, I'm not going out without a fight. And she fought a good fight up until the very end. Out of all of the people Paralee knew, I believe I am one of the few people that she only spoke good words about. I'm serious. I mean, over my whole life, apparently, I always had good words to say about me. So that's a hallmark. Funerals make us think of the reality of life and death. Question, what is death? Ecclesiastes 12 and 7 says, "Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return to God who gave it." Death is not a question that concerns Paralee anymore, because she has passed from this life unto the next. Death is only a concern for those of us yet in the land of the living. Every person within the sound of my voice will face death one day. Surely death will come and knock on your door and my door one day. Are you ready to meet God as Paralee was? So I just want to take a few minutes to speak to those of you in the land of the living. I want to stir your thoughts a little bit with the Word of God about the realities of death. We live in a world that is filled with all kinds of modern conveniences to help save us time. We have automobiles that take us from one place to another place fast. We have microwave ovens to cook our food fast. We have dishwashers to help us save time so we can wash our dishes fast. We have time for some things and not time for others. But when death comes and knocks on our doors, none of the things in our busy lives will matter at all. Time as we know it will come to a screeching halt and to an end. Our busy world around us won't seem as important as it did the day before. When this happens, the only thing that will be important to you is, have you made your peace with God, as Auntie Paralee did? Auntie Lee had made her peace with God. She was ready to go home to be with Jesus. It's something about the peace of God that is powerful. One writer said, "And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus." The peace of God is something that the world can't comprehend, but God knows. In the midst of the tests, in the midst of the storms, we can have peace. And Auntie Lee did. She made her peace with Jesus. So there is no need for us to mourn for Paralee because she's gone to be with her Lord. In the scriptures, Paul was encouraging some not to worry about those that had already died in Christ. 1 Corinthians 15 and 51 says, "In the end, listen, and I will tell you a secret. We shall not all die, but suddenly in the twinkling of an eye, every one of us will be changed when the trumpet sounds. The trumpet will sound, and the dead shall be raised beyond the reach of corruption. And we who are still alive shall suddenly be utterly changed. For this perishable nature of ours must be wrapped in a imperishability. These bodies which are mortal must be wrapped in immortality." So as we think about our precious Auntie Paralee, she's at peace and she's at rest and she's in a better place with our Lord. And this brings our service for today to an end. I'm going to ask our funeral directors to come, if they will. Mary, you have something? Amen. So we're going to have a closing prayer by Pastor Dale before the recessional.
Well, thank you, dear Father, for just being so very good to us, Lord, and your mercy continue to endure forever. Again, we thank you for Aunt Paralee, for just her many gifts, her many talents, and just touching so many lives, Lord. We just thank you, Father. So we know she is with you, Lord. And we just thank you, God. We celebrate. Let's give Lord a hand clap for all that she has done. And she is with the Lord, Lord. We just thank you, God. Thank you, God, for her, Lord. Just touching so many lives, and Lord, and each life that she has touched, they have manifested something good in them, God, Lord. So, God, we thank you. In the name that is above all names, for you get the glory in the heavens and also in the earth. If everybody would say, thank you, Lord. Say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And amen. And amen.
Those that are going to the interment, the funeral directors will direct you after we've closed out and help line up the cars that are going.